Okay, I'm playing with the Omniturns today. We actually rearranged some stuff. So I'm selling this Omniturn, and I can't see myself needing it anytime soon. This one works now, which we talked about before, I think. This one is the one that always worked. So now we have two, they're sitting in kitty corner. We got a bunch of brass. We're chopping up, a lot of exciting stuff happening. Kinda maybe doing mouthpieces, I don't really want to that much. Like, I'm gonna do it for a couple people, but maybe French horn stuff if I get excited. But what I'm doing today is game changing. So one of my,
is this okay? Because this looks like shit.
One of my least favorite things to do in the world is making mouthpipe mandrels. Unluckily for me, there are so many different mouthpipes in the world. I'm no longer able to devote the time that I used to be able to making them. But I still need new ones and different ones, like stuff like that. And this goes for even more stuff because we're doing more trombone stuff, we're doing more French horn stuff. I just need a much more consistent and repeatable and time-conscious way to make mouthpipe mandrels. I got these Omniturns, which are amazing machines. They do some really cool stuff. They make really pretty parts. Yeah, these are the caps we did the other week. They're really, really amazing, precise machines. I got to thinking and I'm like, well, why can't I make mouthpipe mandrels on the Omniturn? The easy answer is, well, you can't stick out 9 inches on a little chucker lathe like this because it would just chatter like shit down here. The astute among you might be saying, what about Swiss lathes? So how Swiss lathes work, this is not a Swiss lathe, of course. How Swiss lathes work is they don't actually use collets, they use something called guide bushings. You know, they're much more expensive, complex machines, but in all intents and purposes, it's the same thing, except for your tools in the Z, so this direction, are rigid. They don't move in Z. Your tools only move in X. And usually there's a gang block here and a gang block here, and then you have drills and it's two spindles. It's a whole complicated mess. But then you have a guide bushing. It's basically a collet, but it's not, it's hard to explain. It clamps onto the material, but the actual spindle assembly-ish moves in Z. So your spindle moves in Z, not your tools. And then what that allows you to do, on a Swiss lathe, you can make a mouthpipe mandrel, keeping your tool stable in Z, only moving it taper in X, and your spindle would push the material out into the cutting tool, which would give you absolute rigidity in your cut. That's the benefit to a Swiss. Well, speed and all that too, but you can zero point cut. No worries about sticking out parts more than you have to. You just kind of go, you can just shove it through. It's like a log splitter. Think of it like a log splitter. Wood chipper. Throw a log in and chips come out. So I got to thinking, I'm like, well, why can't I make this machine with some clever code run like a budget Swiss? Let me show you the code. It's super simple, actually. It took me like 20 minutes to write. And my friend Jeremy is gonna help me make like a Google or like an Excel spreadsheet that will autofill this for me. So basically, there's roughing passes, which are the same. And then these are the tapers. The cool thing, which I'll get to in a second, is it's still the same way I measure as the doing them on manual. We'll taper, like this one in particular, taper from 335, which is our starting, to 340, to 345, 348, and 350 over an inch. Retract and pull out, and then we have stop the spindle, M05, and then we have an M01, which is a optional stop. So that the machine will stop, I can open the collet closer, and then I can pull the material out against my tool, which is that it's whatever the diameter is, 475, and Z0 position, so that I'll be able to bump my material up against this tool to get a repeatable Z. Well, I'll show you this in a second, but optional stop, pull the material out to the exact point, cycle start, it'll do the next inch. And an inch at a time, we're gonna make a mouthpipe mandrel. Spoiler alert, it works like the frickin' tits. So we're gonna run this. The last one crashed on literally the last move because I was an idiot and I put a space in there where it shouldn't have been. So it tried to drag through the material. It went so well. So I fixed that. We should be all good. Nothing bad. They just moved the tool in the tool holder. So nothing bad happened. No servo trips, nothing like that. We are going to finish setting up our tool. I believe I faced it and I'm at Z0. We're going to jog T1, enter. And then we go Z0, sets our Z offset location. And now we're going to actually take a cut, and I'll talk about something else. M03, when I say O, I mean zero. Let's go 1500, which is the speed we're running at for this program. Why didn't I want to go? Oh. So we put it back in a jog mode, and we're gonna yog right up to it, touch, go a little more, and then we're just gonna manually, using my jog wheel or jog joystick, come in here and take about a quarter inch length of cut so we can get some calipers on there. I'm gonna wrap it out. Okay, stop the spindle, try to get my calipers in here. 448, another little pro tip here. We want to machine this mandrel oversized by about 3,000. So we're gonna go tool, one, enter, X. So to make this oversized, we're gonna key in 0.2 4, 4, 5. So 3,000ths less. So that the tool thinks it's 3,000ths more that way. So it'll machine bigger by 3,000ths. Pretty cool. And make sure stick out is enough. It's important to not run into the spindle nose. You just don't want to run into the spindle nose. I've never actually done it. So we don't do that here. Inch and a quarter is plenty. Automagic mode. And yes, I wear safety glasses.
Cool.
Take to turn off the spindle, M05. And this is my budget Swiss lathe. It's pretty freaking tits. I guessed at all the depth of cuts. I haven't done too much steel on here, so I didn't know for sure, but it seems to be working out. So every time it reaches that corner, it's jumping out in both X and Z so that it doesn't drag on either the shoulder or the face of the material. And that's just gonna help our tool life. And that's kind of really important here. If our tool wears like a good amount, which it can in steel, especially because I don't know what this insert is, it's kind of a questionable insert, that's gonna mess up our stop length. Especially if it chips and I have to change an insert, that could wreck a mandrel. We're just gonna take it nice and easy, try not to bump anything. Okay, this is the last pass, the next one's gonna be the taper. You can actually see both X and Z moving there. So that's cutting a taper. And surface finish isn't hugely important here, because we're gonna take this on the belt sander and then buffer to make it usable for drawing. Okay, so there's our first optional stop. So we're gonna open our collet, and I'm gonna try and do this one-handed.
It's a little warm.
Whew. Bump it forward so I can get a hold on the not warm part. There we go. I probably can't do this one-handed. Look at that. It fits. So, no, I'm pulling the material away from the collet because the collet's going to try to suck it in. Because we don't want it to suck in. Hey, there's a gap. That's what we don't want. Try that again. It's sucking it back. That looked a lot better. Yep. That's all good. Too much tension on the collet. Okay, so then we just hit cycle start. And it does the second pass. I should probably bump this fade rate up so I can get some better chips, but they're not too bad. I'd really rather not push this machine in steel because I don't know, I just don't think it's necessary. So something that's probably really important with this is getting good straight drill rod stock. This is 01 tool steel. And this steel is from McMaster Car. And over the years, I've noticed that the drill rod, it looks and feels cheaper and cheaper from McMaster Car. So I might look for some not McMaster Car, actually good, like straight, good surface finish steel. I just feel like it's getting more and more questionable. This is the taper now. So, and when I am approaching the start of the taper, the tool's actually half of a thousandth. It's keyed up half of a thousandth of an inch of a, Jesus Christ, yeah, half of a thousandth of an inch away from the surface that had already cut the previous operation. And that's just so that we don't have any rubbing. And half a thousandth is not gonna make a huge difference on the finished product. Wow, that's warm. This is probably something I should run coolant on, but I don't really feel like putting coolant on this machine.
At the moment.
I should get like some feeler gauges to kind of like shove between there. That looks good though. And you can see, this end is running pretty impressively concentric. I was worried the longer we go out, the worse it would get. And it does get not 100% perfect, but it's within a couple thousandths, which is perfectly acceptable. Again, considering that we are gonna be grinding and polishing this stuff. So this is the taper. You can see it's just barely touching when it comes up to the approach, which is good. When you G00 is the rapid command, so that means the machine's gonna move as fast as possible. So you usually use those for linking moves, so moves in between cutting moves. If you G00 to where you want the cut to be, it's very likely that the machine will miss, because when you're moving a servo that fast, apparently it's not guaranteed to be positionally accurate. If you want to go to 0.4 on X, you're gonna wrap it to like 0.41 and then G01, so slowly feed move into 400. But like I can't, like visually I can see a line there. I can't feel a line. We're talking tenths. It's pretty amazing. Just keep going. Oh, you know what? I'm gonna try this. I'm gonna push against the nylon with like my body weight. That did not work. Let me try again. That looks good.
Yeah, that's a good trick.
Then we hit cycle start. And you can see our dingus end is running very true. It's kind of scary how good it is. Literally my second try too. It's pretty amazing. Never goes like this. And we just changes. Keep going.
So this is very thrilling for everyone.
It's just so fun to see this, like, sticking out. It does not, like, look right. Yeah, so this machine actually has the Z length to stick a part out like this. But, I mean, on any part, it, max collet size this can do is 1 1/8 inches. Even on an 1 1/8 inch part, you're not sticking out that much. It's not going to happen. So basically, I used the same roughing passes for every step, but I either deleted or altered the last smallest roughing step to accommodate a good enough size finish pass. Because if your finish pass is too light, it's not going to be good. It's going to chatter and make some weird noises. So I got really lucky with my guesses, which never happens. I'm usually very unlucky with my guesses. I think we have two or three more. That's not good. That is not good at all. I went too far. Okay, so I think that tells me that I need to move in my stop. Yeah, it sucks, but it's okay. Tip of the tool looks okay. Yeah, it's just because the collet, the material fits in the collet loose. We should be okay. That's something I gotta alter. Right now it's going to 0.475. At that stop, I'll make it like 450 or something. I wanted to make them all the same just for the sake of whatever code Jeremy's gonna write. But if I make them like 455, then they'll all fit. So 20,000 should be enough to account for that. This is the taper. It's gonna get quicker and quicker, less roughing passes every time. I think the first one had 4 roughing passes and then the last one has like 1. Okay, let's try this again. Getting longer. Feeling out here just to see if I feel a lot of vibrations, and I really don't. And you can see, it's not really wobbling. It's pretty amazing. Yeah, this is the second to last pass, I believe. If I was really worried about run out, I bet I could make like a little bronze like bushing to just like let this tip run on, but it's doing fine. Like it's running out a little bit right now, but it's probably like 2,000s. I could measure it if I really cared, but honestly I don't. This is the taper now. I'm not worried about that run out at all. It's better than when I do it on manual. Surface finish is really nice, especially considering it doesn't matter. Get the chip off the tool. Cutting the taper. We got one more pass after this. The last one's the one that messed up last time, so hopefully my fixes work. That did something wrong. There's a little dish right here. That's not right. I think I might have mistyped the digit there. That's a bummer, but we'll finish it out just to make sure that this last pass doesn't destroy itself. But the second to last pass has something wrong with it. I might stop this one just to read the code on the screen when it comes up to make sure I don't mess it up again. Yep, that's right. Beautiful. Beautiful. Yeah, we roughed out more than we needed to, but that is awesome. So all I gotta look at is this weird dish. So let's go into F3. Escape. I bet there's just one digit off by like 5,000s. It looks like it was the third pass, so I gotta go all the way to the end. It's very exciting. That's a freaking mouthpipe mandrel. So we did up to where it hit the bore, which is 460 on this one, and then I would take this on my manual machine and put it between centers and just machine the rest of the mandrel, which is like 4 inches, at the 460. Rather than doing this, it wouldn't blend as well as you think. Find the last one, then we'll go up one. So something was wrong with our taper on the last one. We went 435. Whoa, that was a big step. That's what it is. So our starting point for the taper is 442, and our first digit is 435. It should be 445. So it dipped in 7,000s. But that's it. That is awesome. Let's pull this one all the way out. I mean, I guess I could do the bore on this on here. Well, let me measure what I actually ended up at. Holy shit, that's so awesome. Yeah, I tried to get it 3,000s oversize, I think. That's so awesome. It came out 2,000s oversize, which is fine. Now I know for the next one, I just need to add 1,000s to my tool offset. So this is the 460 end. This is that dish where we just fixed. There's our finish. So you can see where the steps are, but you cannot feel them. I mean, it just shows the accuracy of this machine. That is so awesome. This is gonna make my life so much easier. Okay, so I'm not gonna do another one tonight because it's 5 a.m, but I know this works. So what I need to do is I need to get the updated version off of this onto my flash drive. Thank you. This has been an experience. Now you've met my budget Swiss lathe. Maybe someday I'll have a real Swiss, but for now I have my budget one. It cost $500 and it does a pretty dang good job. Honestly, as good of a job as I need it to. Maybe we'll start selling mouthpipe mandrels on the website for all the standard stuff. I don't know, maybe. I think it would be pretty cool to do that. No talking to anyone, you could just do your own thing. Maybe we'll keep you posted on that. Cool. See you later.